Good evening. A special welcome to our guests and visitors today. It's always a pleasure to have you. We continue with our theme, top-down faith. Our gracious God is with us through all the storms of life. As we go through life, we know that there will be storms, that there will be downpours and struggles that we endure, but we do not have to fear them because we know who's in the boat with us. We have Jesus by our side. We have Jesus, our Lord, watching over us all our days and guiding us through those difficult times until he delivers us to our heavenly home. And in him we trust. We ask God to bless our worship today, and we begin with our opening hymn. Please stand. We begin today in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord Jesus, you are the light of the world, the light no darkness can overcome. Stay with us, for it is evening, and the day is almost done. Let your light scatter the darkness. Let it shine in our hearts and lives. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you in our thoughts, in our words, in our acts, and all that we have not done. Forgive us in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Deliver and restore us, that we may rest in peace. By the mercy of God, we have been bought back from sin, death, and hell by the perfect life and innocent death of Jesus Christ. In him we are forgiven. Let us rest in his peace until the rising of the sun, when we shall serve him in newness of life. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord our God, so govern the nations on earth and direct the affairs of this world, that your church may worship you in peace and joy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. We join in singing the psalm.
Amen.
First reading for today is Job chapter 38, verses 1 to 11. Job questioned why God had allowed trouble to befall him. Out of a storm, the Lord spoke to Job, explaining that no mere man has the capacity to understand the wonderful ways God works. Then the Lord spoke to Job. Out of the storm, he said, "Who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me, if you understand, who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched the measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone? While the morning stars sang together, and all the angels shouted for joy, who shut up the sea behind doors when it burst forth from the womb? When I made the clouds its garments and wrapped it in thick darkness, when I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place, when I said, 'This far you may come and no farther, here is where your proud waves halt.'" The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second reading is Acts chapter 27, verses 13 to 26. St. Paul and others were on a boat in the middle of a hurricane. God did not call a storm, yet he was with them in the storm, accomplishing his good and gracious work. When the gentle south wind began to blow, they saw their opportunity, so they weighed anchor and sailed along the shore of Crete. Before very long, a wind of a hurricane force called a northeasterner swept down from the island. The ship was caught by the storm and could not head into the wind. So we gave way to it and were driven along. As we passed to the lee of a small island called Cauda, we were hardly able to make the lifeboat secure. So the men hoisted it aboard. Then they passed ropes under the ship itself to hold it together, because they were afraid they would run aground on the sandbar of Cyprus. They lowered the sea anchor and let the ship be driven along. We took such a violent battering from the storm that the next day they began to throw the cargo overboard. On the third day, they threw the ship's tackle overboard with their own hands. When neither sun nor stars appeared for many days and the storm continued raging, we finally gave up all hope of being saved. After they had gone a long time without food, Paul stood up before them and said, "Men, you should have taken my advice not to sail from Crete. Then you would have spared yourselves this danger and loss. But now I urge you to keep up your courage, because not one of you will be lost. Only the ship will be destroyed. Last night, an angel of the Lord God, to whom I belong and whom I serve, stood beside me and said, 'Do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand trial before Caesar, and God has graciously given you the lives of all who sail with you. So keep up your courage, men, for I have faith in God that it will happen just as he told me. Nevertheless, we must run aground on some island.'" The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the gospel acclamation. We join saying the gospel acclamation together. Alleluia. They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." Alleluia. The gospel reading for today is Mark chapter 4, verses 35 to 41. This will serve as our sermon text for today. Even the winds and the waves must obey Jesus Christ, our Lord. The day when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let's go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why were you afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." The gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Grace and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is in the boat of life with you, who is guiding you through your struggles and in your problems, guiding you to him, to trust in him, because he has power over everything and will save you from this world and bring you to his eternal kingdom by his grace and mercy. Amen. My sister and her husband are in the States right now. They're here for about 3 weeks. Where they live is in Ecuador. They live in the mountains of Quito. Her husband has been a missionary down there for several years. He was a classmate of mine. And my sister moved down there in November after they got married. And they've been serving the people there for quite some time and online. But when they were here, we were at my parents' place for brunch in the morning, and we were talking about their lives and things like that, and we got into a discussion of idioms, like picture-type things, you know, like picture languages, and we were kind of saying, you know, what are some that are here in the States, and what are some that are in Ecuador? You know, if you're joking with somebody, you might say, "I'm pulling your leg," right? Well, they say, "They're pulling your hair." Another one is like if you're really focused and you're just kind of in that element, you might say they're in their element, right? He's in his zone of sorts. Well, they might say he's in his salsa. And you kind of like you really think about these things and they're like, you know, they don't really make sense. They're just kind of things that we use. But as I thought about our text today, I thought of one that we use quite often maybe. You know, the idiom I thought of was, when it rains, it pours. And you might use that one, and you might think, okay, when will I use this? Or when do I use this? It's when one thing after another that is bad happens. You know, you think about it like this. Here's an example. You're driving down the highway, you get a flat. You pull the car over, and you look, and you see that your jack is broken. And then you look at your phone, and you're about to call for help, and then your phone dies. And then you're outside, and then all of a sudden it starts to rain. When it rains, it pours. And you think about this, you know, there's a lot of different ways this might hit us. It might be in like a moment or a day, right? Or otherwise it could last weeks. It could last months. Can feel like years we're in this kind of downpour. But I think often when we're in these downpours, we feel like we're alone, right? You know, we feel like, I can't get any help. I can't get any relief. Who's there for me? But it doesn't matter if it's physical or spiritual. I want to reassure you today that God is with us and that he's with us through our storms. You know, you think about storms of life, they kind of pop up when you least expect them, right? They just seem like they just appear without you kind of knowing that they're coming. You think about actual storms, they kind of operate the same way. Yeah, we have our phones, and you know, if you're having a big party or going to an event, you can see what the weather is going to be like in a week, right? Or you watch the nightly weather and you're like, well, it's going to rain tomorrow. Or if you're looking at the radar, you can see the storm coming from miles or even states away. But still, sometimes I'm outside or I'm going about my day and a storm will seem like it came out of nowhere, even with all this technology. You know, on Monday this past week, we were supposed to go to my oldest son Aiden's T-ball game. And we were only like a couple hours away, and I was excited to go because sometimes I have meetings and things like that, and I was free that night. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, here's a storm coming down, and his game was canceled. You know, these storms just come our way, and we don't expect them. You know, the same thing is true for our spiritual life or just our struggles, right? You know, a gentleman that we heard of in our Old Testament reading, that happened to him, Job. You know, to his perspective and his view, that this suffering and this struggle, this earthly storm came out of nowhere. When he lost his family, he lost his possessions, his servants, and his health. Yes, God knew it was coming. Yes, God allowed it to happen. But here is Job from his perspective. When it rains, it pours. You know, you think about Paul and his missionary journeys as the ship was saved and went aground on the island. You think of him being put in prison and suffering for the faith and being beaten. You know, he didn't know when these things would come. You know, these storms of life just kind of pop up. You know, how did the disciples feel, right? How did the disciples feel with the storm that was on them? You kind of wonder if they had, you know, cell phones and a radar, would they have set sail on that sea that day? You know, if they knew the storm was coming, would they have just said, let's wait another day, Jesus? This is not good. This doesn't look like a good storm to be in. You know, when they were on that sea, did they start to get nervous when they saw the storm rolling in? You know, you had experienced fishermen. You know, they see those dark clouds and think, oh, this is not good. Or did it start kind of drizzling and they're like, you know, we really need to get out of here as fast as we can? You know, or were they absolutely terrified as it started pouring down upon them and the wind started beating against the boat and the waves started crashing and spraying into the boat? You know, how terrified were they? Well, we hear that day when evening came, he said to his disciples, let's go over to the other side. Verse 36, leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. You know, could you picture this? You know, here's this boat that the disciples are in, and now the water's filling it up. You know, here's the wind that's bashing against them. Here are experienced fishermen that are eventually absolutely terrified. You know, could you picture them kind of bailing out the water from the boat as fast as they could? And no matter how fast they went, that boat seemed to fill up even faster. You know, here they are seeing the conditions. They're weighing the possibilities here. It's not like they can, you know, call for the Coast Guard to come flying in with a helicopter and pull them out of this situation. It's not like they could send out a signal of distress, right? What are they going to do? What can they do? Well, we see everyone else is working to keep the boat afloat. But we see one that's sleeping. One that is calmly relaxed in the boat, taking a nap. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, Teacher, don't you care if we drown? You know, essentially they were on the thinking, you know, we're on the brink of death, Jesus. You know, we are about to die. there's a few different thoughts here about how, you know, the disciples were kind of thinking and whatnot. You know, there's a thought that, you know, they woke Jesus up thinking that they could, that he would help them. Well, you know, that thought maybe is a little in question because of what Jesus says later. You know, why did you have so little faith? Do you not believe, essentially? You know, the other perspective is then, you know, were they just waking Jesus up to say, hey, Jesus, we're in this predicament. We've been working hard for minutes or hours to keep this boat afloat. Do you not care if you die or not? It seems like we're not going to make it. You know, don't you want to pick a bucket and start shoveling this water out with us? You know, you could almost picture them kind of getting upset with Jesus. Like, how can you sleep through this? You know, the boat is going to sink and we're all going to drown and die. But you kind of think from our perspective, we say, you know, disciples, who was in the boat with you? It was Jesus. You know, why did you fear? Why did you doubt? You know, he's there. There is your God. You know, you see these storms come in, right, that we endure. When it rains, it pours. I know you have your own sufferings. You've had sufferings. You have had your own pains and struggles. Sometimes you share that with me and how humbling that is to walk along with our members during these downpours, to pray for them, to encourage them with God's word. But I have to say, I have these moments too. I have these days where it just feels like when it rains, it pours. You know, it could be as simple as like you're writing your sermon and then the power goes out and you delete your whole sermon and then you have to start over and it's just like there's one issue after another and things don't seem to go right and you're reminded, I'm not in heaven. Or otherwise, it can be things a little more serious, right? Maybe it's my own mind that's playing tricks on me again. The same battle that I endure day in and day out. What do your storms look like? What have you endured? Has it been one of those days where it's like you get a flat tire on the road and then a few days later your air conditioning goes out and then you have some other thing break and it's just like, here's my black cloud that's following me around. Or maybe you go to the hospital for just a routine checkup, and it seems like they're finding one thing after another thing after another thing. And you're just like, when is this going to stop? When am I going to get out of this hospital? Or maybe you're going about your life, and everything seems good, and then all of a sudden you get laid off. You lose your job, and everything seems to spiral from there. How am I going to buy my food? How am I going to make ends meet? Or maybe you too endure those mental struggles, those anxieties that weigh heavy on you. You know, it just seems like no matter what you do, it just seems like it's going to keep on pouring and pouring hard. Maybe you feel like a modern-day Job. You know, how do we handle these moments? How do we feel like we get through them? I kind of wonder if we handle them like the disciples. Do we pick up our buckets and start bailing ourselves out? And we're frantically trying to get as much water out of the boat as possible, but the waves keep crashing in over and over again, and we're just like, this is over our heads. There's water up to my knees. Again, I feel like I've done this. You know, here's a challenge. I know God's by my side, but I'm the one who has to get myself out of this. I need to go here and here and here. I need to make this appointment and that appointment to try to get myself out of this mess. I need to get myself out of my drowning, this pouring. You know what I quickly realize? It's still pouring, even when I do those things. The water seems to go from my knees to my waist and up to my neck. You know, so often we think, you know, I can get myself out of this. I'll be okay. Lord, I'm still breathing. Or even in those moments, how often do we say, Lord, what are you doing? Are you not by my side? Why is this happening, God? You know, why am I suffering? Why am I enduring these pains? Lord, aren't you by my side? As to question his loyalty, to question his will and his desire and what is good for us. Yes, like Job, he may allow these things to happen. Satan may go to his kingdom and say, you know, Lord, you know, these people are loyal to you just because their life is good. Okay, you can take it away. Why would he do that? Well, because he has his hold on his people. Satan cannot snatch them from him. You know, during our suffering and our struggle, the Lord holds us fast. The Lord gives us the assurance that he is there in the storm. And we know that he'll do this because he has the power to do it. Does he not? We hear, he got up, verse 39, rebuked the wind and said to the waves, quiet, be still. Then the winds died down and it was completely calm. You know, whether it's sunny out, whether it's raining, whether it's pouring, whatever life sends our way, God, the all-powerful Lord, is in control. You know, the creator who created the creation from his voice, that creation must listen to its creator. It must bow down before it, and it doesn't matter if it's the wind or the waves. It must listen to his rebuke. It must listen to when he speaks. And it's not just the wind, the waves, the storms, the sun, the moon, the stars, the galaxies, the planets. No, it is also the creatures that walk upon the earth. It is also the humans that must bow down to the Almighty God who is in control of all things. Those creatures must bow down and acknowledge his power and might and authority and give him praise and glory. This God and Lord, you know, even the angels and demons must bow before his throne. They must acknowledge and obey his commands. They cannot do as they will. They go about trying to tear apart God's kingdom, but his kingdom continues to stand. His kingdom continues to reign and rule. This is our God who was in the boat with his disciples, who was there guiding them and would have gotten them to the shore no matter what the storm was. But what does he say to his disciples? He says this. He said to his disciples, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? You know, I think it's kind of interesting. We're not told specifically that God rebuked them. You know, you hear that word, rebuked the wind. He rebuked the wind. But we're not told that he rebuked the disciples in this harsh or powerful way. Yes, he questions them. Yes, he makes them think. But here is the God of grace and mercy. Why are you so afraid, right? Why are you so concerned? You have the God of all things right here in the boat with you. Why are you worried about it? Do you not yet believe? Do you not have faith? Do you not trust me that I will guide and protect you? You know, I told you that I have a purpose for you to go out into the world, to go and share that message with many people. You know, I am going to do the many things. You know, as disciples listen to the words of Jesus, it brings this question into their mind. They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him." Who is this? This is Jesus. This is our Lord and God. This is their Savior. This is our Savior. This is the God who shows them, hey, you have peace with me. You have peace in the storms of life. You have peace as I walk with you. And God does the same with you. Does God care about you in the midst of your suffering and pain? Yes, he does. He cares about you immensely. You think about the storms that Jesus endured for us on that dark Friday. You think about the downpour of God's wrath upon him as Jesus endured the punishment for your sin and mine. The punishment that we were supposed to endure. It was supposed to be a complete downpour of God's judgment as he casts us off into hell's fires for all eternity. This is what we deserve. But instead, Jesus endured that downpour for us so that God could be with us and be our God and be our Father and be our heavenly brother and King. This is where Jesus gave up his life on the cross for your sins. He could not die in this boat by drowning. No, he had to make it to the cross. He had to make it to that place where he would give up his life and say, "It is finished. It is done." And we see our Jesus have command over death as he comes back to life on that Easter morn. Does your Lord have command over the storms in your life? Yeah, he does. Of course he does. If he's able to do as much as he's done for our salvation, he can be there for any storm. He will be there for any storm. Yes, the storms you face will come your way. And I don't know what kind of storms you will face. I don't know when they will come. I don't know what they will be for my life. I don't know what will come my way and what time they will come. You know, I think sometimes we get into this mindset of, you know, when life is good, you kind of get comfortable. You're just like, there's not going to be any storms. And then you get kind of relaxed in your prayer life, in your devotion life. And then what happens? Here's a big storm. Here's a storm where it makes you look up and look to your God. Here is God using this storm to strengthen your relationship with him, to not call on him in the moment of drowning, but the moments you see the storm rolling in. The times and opportunities you have to pray to your God, "Lord, I see the storm coming," or I see the storm hitting me now. Be with me. Give me strength. Give me encouragement. Give me your support. Remind me that you are by my side as I endure this storm, as I endure this downpour. And even in those midst of peace, don't we all often have that mindset too, like there's a storm on the edge? You know, there's a storm that could be coming. But God says, think about now. Be concerned about today. I'm in control. Don't worry about tomorrow. For tomorrow has its own worries and concerns. You know, each day is his own. Each day is a gift that he has given us. And he's going to walk through each day that he blesses us with. So let's trust in God. Let's trust the one who's in the boat with us. Let's trust that he'll navigate us through this life and the storms that we experience to our eternal home that he has won for us in our salvation. Oh, what a blessing that is. What a comfort that is. That no matter how hard the devil works and all the struggles that we face, our King lives. Our Jesus rules. He is all-powerful and mighty, and nothing can take us down. Nothing can destroy us because he is lifting us up. He is holding us up. May we always trust him. Yes, the storms aren't easy. Yes, they are difficult. But pray to your God. There's something that I've been doing more, even as a pastor, and that's praying. I've been trying to make it more of a focal point in my life. You might be saying, hey, pastor, you know, shouldn't you be doing those things? Yeah, I'm human too. You get caught up in the storms. You get caught up in life. You're like, you wake up in the morning, it's like, I should hit the email. I should hit the books. You know, I should be running around doing my work. But we need time with God. Because we don't know, again, the storms that come that day. So maybe start the day with prayer. Pray in the morning. Pray at night before bed. Saying, Lord, thank you for getting me through this day. Lord, if it is your will, and you give us another day, get me through those storms too. No, I'd like to kind of end with a prayer here. Lord, stay by my side all my days. When the struggles of life seem to consume me, deliver me from my anguish. Lord, through your Spirit, strengthen my faith to trust that you will do what is good and right as things seem to pour down on me. Remember your promise that you will never leave me nor forsake me, O Lord. For Jesus' name, we pray that all this. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God which transpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We join in confessing our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, God of grace and mercy, you know the storms that come in our lives. You know that we always need help. And in the moments of drowning in our anguish and pain, you send your Holy Spirit by your word to save us from our anguish, to save us from our pain, so that we may look to your cross and find relief in your love through the Savior who died for us. Yes, those pains and those struggles, those crosses that we carry in your name, yes, they are painful, but we know that you will use them for our good, to strengthen our faith in you and to trust in you all our days. Help us to keep our eyes fixed on you, no matter what the life weather is like. May we enjoy the blessing of salvation and that Jesus is in this boat of life with us, guiding and praying for us, so that we may be delivered to our eternal home. Amen. And we join to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and keep us. Amen. You may be seated. We conclude with a closing hymn. Good evening. Nice to worship with all of you. If you're a guest, it's nice to have you worship with us. If you'd like some more information, just kind of speak with me after the service, and we're more than happy to help you. Just letting you know, if you don't know this, the Ford and Christ magazines that are in the back of the church, they're free to take. Anyone can take them. There's some nice ones in here that I thought. There's one on prayer. If you're kind of wondering, you know, how to pray and some thoughts. There's other articles in here that are, I thought, were kind of interesting. So if you feel like kind of picking a copy up, feel free to do that on your way out. There's a couple still from last month, so if you haven't looked at those, please do. Just kind of working through a couple of things, kind of looking ahead. The 4th of July falls on Thursday, so that kind of, you know, I'm happy to have another service, you know, like that day, but I'm kind of wondering if a lot of people are just going to be gone that day, you know, so we're kind of leaning towards not having the service, but since you're the Thursday people, you know, is that okay? Oh, yeah, okay, so I'm thinking we'll cancel Thursday service next week for the 4th of July, so you're invited to come to our Sunday service at 9, and then the week after we will pick that up. It just kind of is what it is in a certain way. So if you have any questions or anything like that, feel free to talk with me, and I'll be happy to kind of go through those. So that's kind of the plan right now. So thanks for kind of understanding, and I hope everybody has safe travels if you're going somewhere and stuff like that. Other than that, I don't think I have any other announcements. So God's blessings on the rest of your week, and hope to see you next week.